Welcome back to a bonus episode of Meeting of the Minds, the interview discussion show that explores hot-button topics in the theism-atheism landscape in a civil and respectful way. I'm your host, Christopher Mowdy, and I'm thrilled to have as my guest this afternoon Mr. Aaron Ra, an atheist activist, an informal science educator via YouTube posts, and someone I've never seen smile. So I'm kind of hoping that as a goal of mine today that I can crack enough jokes to break the stoic exterior of Mr. Aaron Ra. And I hope that that's just because of the selection of videos that I've seen, but we're going to see if we can crack a smile today. How are you doing today, Aaron?
It's all right. Happy to be here. Are we on video?
Yeah, we're on video right now.
All right. Good deal.
Okay, so you're not going to be able to see the actual video because we don't want any distractions. We prefer if you look right into the camera, so we're not actually be able to see each other. So it's a virtual interview in that respect.
All right. Will do.
So I'd like to take just a moment up front to do a little housekeeping. As some of you know, this is the second show of Meeting of the Minds today. And I had an earlier one at 2 o'clock Central, 3 o'clock Eastern, and my guest was Steve Shives, and that was a super fun discussion. And next week I will also have two shows, one at 2 o'clock Central and one at 4 o'clock Central. The one at 2 o'clock will be dealing with free will and determinism. And the one at 5 o'clock, I will be interviewing a gentleman that self-identifies himself as an atheist Satanist. So please make sure that you stop by next week to check that out. After next week's shows, I will be officially occupying the 4 o'clock Central time slot. So if you tune in looking for Dowell's show, Mr. Furlow's Neighborhood, which used to air at this time, you can now catch him first thing in the New Covenant Group broadcast at 10 o'clock Central, 11 o'clock Eastern. All right, that's it. Thank you very much, Aaron, for your patience. So I'd like to start the show with a couple of introductory questions, and these pretty much just help me and the viewing audience get a sense for where you stand on a couple of things that I think that we're all interested in. So how would you identify yourself or describe your worldview?
All right, I describe myself as an epistemist, atheist, and an epistemist is somebody who it's not that the God we reject necessarily. It's not that we reject reject religion necessarily. But the thing that I reject is faith. That I see as the crux of the whole problem. I also see faith as being the most dishonest position it is possible to have.
Okay. And so how does that describe your worldview? If that's your perspective of faith, how does that influence your worldview about maybe your goals and the things that that are drawn from that? How does that manifest?
Well, from my perspective, I mean, thinking as a scientist, I mean, the purpose of science is to improve understanding, and therefore only accurate information can have practical application. I mean, in order to improve your position, you must first find the flaws in your current perspective and correct them. And you have to be able to know which are corrections and which are not just, you know, blind alley streaming. You have to be able to know which direction to change the course to make it more correct. So everything has to be based on evidence. A scientist cannot say that something probably happened unless he can show the data indicating that probability. He certainly cannot say that something did or does happen, or that something necessarily does exist, if he can't show overwhelming preponderance of data indicating exactly that. In religion, you can assert anything you want to for no reason at all and simply call it fact. But if a scientist does that, that's considered fraud. For some reason, when religious people do that, it's called revealed truth.
Okay. So so that's a very clear definition of how you feel about evidential things. How about things that are less evidential? Like, where do you draw your sense of morality from? Where do you draw your sense of ethics from?
I would say that morality and ethics, and these, of course, are going to be variable for everybody. But as we have evolved as a social species, you know, a societal species, it is naturally embedded in us to have a certain degree of empathy or altruism to our family, friends, and fellows. That it is not the individual's survival that matters in any case, because no man is an island. It is the society that that matters and that must preserve. We can think easily about how the world will be when we ourselves are dead. But it's a strange thing to think about what would happen to the rest of humanity at some future point. I remember being a child and hearing that the sun was going to burn out at some far distant point in the future. And, of course, this is going to be many years after I have myself am dead. Mm-hmm. But I thought it was a sad thing that all those people living after me would reach their ultimate demise as well. So it was the species level consideration that was bothering me, not my own life. And that's where it becomes very Vulcan, you know, the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few or the one. And I think that people largely actually do feel that way. And religion, in my perspective, often tries to defy that. Defy what is naturally inherent in most of us. And as I said, there's going to be a degree of variance. There are going to be people who have not so much development in their prefrontal lobes, who maybe don't have motor neurons, who maybe suffer from sociopathic tendencies or what have you, and don't feel empathy or a value of truth.
Sure, but they're considered anomalies for a reason.
What's that?
Oh, I was just reaffirming what you were saying by mentioning that people with schizophrenia or people with a damage to the prefrontal cortex, you know, their behavior manifests as socially inappropriate, and they're considered anomalous for a reason.
Right. And if you note, yeah, obviously aberrant behaviors are going to emerge. You know, it's random dice roll for your genetics, and aberrant behaviors are going to emerge. But these usually are removed from the gene pool. Usually in a prison system or being banished to outside the community or what have you. That's the way people would deal with these. And so as a matter of population mechanics, what you end up with as the dominant factor are the people who show the traits for empathy, for altruism, for self-sacrifice, and for working together for a common cause and for the generosity and charity of others. And this has been going on since at least Homo erectus, at least. So this is where I would say that I get my morality from. If we have a basis on that, we want to understand the way things really are. Okay, then we're going to want to have a love of truth. And if we have a love of truth, then we are going to detest lies. And this is where we get into our first conflict with religion. Okay. We want to be able to show that the information is accurate and that we're not just making stuff up. So we end up with these laws of science that we have to follow in which religion doesn't. And that's why atheists like myself tend to be so overtly anti-religious, because it stands against everything we hold true or everything we hold moral. Because if you look at the moral precepts for all at least of the mainstream religions, what they propose as a morality, as a moral standard, is anything but moral.
Okay, so moving on to a couple more introductory questions. Did Jesus exist?
I would say, and I thought that Jesus did exist once upon a time, and the only indications that I had that he did were moments like when he comes to the fig tree and there's no fruit on it, and so he gets angry and curses the tree, right? Now, these are clearly not a description of an actual God or a being that has wisdom beyond his species or any of this. These are folk tales that could easily be related to a real person. There was this one story where Jesus goes back into his hometown, and the miracles that he does for other people, when he gets people around people who know him, they see right through the sham. They don't buy any of it. And for this reason, I thought Jesus was a historical character, that he was some small-time cult leader. He was taken out and dispatched early on for being a heretic and for putting himself before God, saying he's the gateway for God, which, of course, is a violation of the very first commandment. He would have been in violation of Hebrew law and having nothing at all to do with the Romans. And I think what ended up happening was, or I thought at the time, that what ended up happening was that he was just, you know, his exploits were exaggerated in order to find some justification in his life. But in later, or more recently, I've been associated with Price and Fitzgerald and Carrier. And all three of these historians are convinced that, for various reasons that they've been able to explain to me, they don't think that Jesus ever actually existed as even a template character that was then exaggerated. They think it's a compilation of a handful of other people, much like Moses evidently was, so that there was not one person that you could point to and say, this was the historical Jesus. In the same sense, there is not one person that you could point to and say, this is the historical Moses.
Okay. And so, so you're kind of recently phased into this different understanding that resonates with you a lot more with these academics that have the theories that, that question or put into question the historicity of Jesus?
Yeah, I'm sure there was a cult leader at some point, some small town virtual nobody that contributed to part of the story. So there's one person more than anybody else that might fit that description vaguely. But there wouldn't be enough there that anybody would be able to recognize it, even if you had a time machine and could go back and watch. You would not be able to find Jesus with a TARDIS.
All right. Do you accept anything supernatural?
No.
Okay. That was nice and simple. What is your opinion of the Bible?
The Bible is the most repugnant tome it has ever been my misfortune to try and peruse. It is a jumbled compilation of contradictions, absurdities, atrocities, and atrocious stupidity. It appears to, it cannot be the word of God. And if there was a God, it would have nothing to do with that book.
Mm-hmm. And are you talking specifically about the King James Version or any English translation or any translation that has ever existed?
Any translation that has ever existed. And by that, I'm including a lot more than a lot of other people do. I mean, the oldest Bible that I'm aware of that they currently know of, I think they just discovered less than a year ago, I think, or positively identified less than a year ago, where they have some of the books out of order. And they have books in this Bible that that don't exist in more recent works that have been removed by human editors, and that there are corrections written into the document because it was a living document that people kept adding to and retracting from. I mean, the Bible makes references at least, well, more than a dozen times. In both the Old Testament and the New Testament, the Bible makes references to other books that have since been removed by human editors. And logically, you'd have to think that if God is infallible and omnipresent and omnipotent, that he would have controlled the construct of his book, and he certainly wouldn't have included references to other books that are no longer part of that, because he wouldn't have allowed them to be removed, or he wouldn't include references to books that were written by humans. So if it were written by God, then the entire thing would have to be held together. You wouldn't have books that were referenced but absent.
Okay. What led you to your current beliefs?
Well, there's first a logical analysis of some of the things that just don't make sense. I mean, it is never possible for snakes to talk. Just start right there. Likewise, it is not possible for donkeys to talk. And we have both of these going on in Genesis. And these are parallels with other religions. I mean, so when I was in high school, I remember, why are we teaching Roman and Greek mythology when they're practically the same thing? And they will teach some of the, maybe the Norse mythos, but we never hear anything about the Persian mythos or the Indian or the Egyptian. And why is this? And I was told that these were too controversial. And I couldn't understand, how could mythology be controversial? And then when I got a hold of things like Enuma Elish and some of the earlier Zoroastrian works and so on, I started to see, yeah, exactly why it's controversial is because the origins of the Bible come from previous polytheism.
All right. And were you ever a theist in your in your journey towards your current beliefs?
Yes. It was, in fact, at a point in my life when everybody believed that there was a God, and I didn't know that it was even possible to question that. Questioning whether a God existed or not seemed as absurd a question as questioning whether there really was a president of the United States. Everybody believed there was. Nobody had any question about it. And everybody that I knew, and this is everyone I respect and everyone in my family and all my friends, told me that God was a conclusively proven scientific fact. which, of course, it's not, and was grossly misrepresented to me. So when it became possible for me, when I realized that it was possible to question legitimately whether this God even existed and whether anybody had any evidence for it, I believe that everybody believed whatever they do for a reason, and that that reason was evidence, and that you ask anybody why you believe X, they would be able to show you all the concordant strings of evidence that indicate that idea. Now, it's true of anything that goes on in history. If you believe, you know, that Blackbeard was, you know, was William Teach or Edward Teach or whatever his real name was, I mean, you would have strings of evidence that would imply this over some other option. And I thought that everybody would be just as objective on all aspects. But
and
when it
then
comes
you're hit
to
with the reality
belief,
of life, right?
Objectivity goes out of the window, and these people believe as an act of will. They make believe. They have to believe because they're being punished or rewarded, not by what they do, but by what they believe. And so they have been. I've listened to preachers say that you have to assert your convictions, which, from the aspect of a scientist, is completely dishonest. Once again, that is where we would draw the line at fraud. And yet that's what the religious community does. So I started realizing that there was a whole different perspective or philosophy with respect to religious beliefs, which were based on faith, and I didn't understand faith. I believed the misrepresentation that faith was equivalent to trust when it is not. It turns out that there's two contexts in the dictionary. If faith is a secure confidence in the validity or veracity of a given idea, then I have faith and creationists don't, because I will walk into any conflict of those two ideas knowing that I'm going to prevail on it because I've got all the goods and they don't. But if faith is in the religious context, which is defined not just in dictionaries but in every other definitive source, as a secure conviction that is assumed without reason and maintained against all reason, then I do not have faith. It is a completely dishonest position to have, and the creationists that I am opposing have a statement of faith wherein, and this is all of them, by the way, they have a statement of faith wherein they admit openly that they have already rejected any and all evidence that may ever arise that opposes their position, and that they will never admit when they are proven wrong.
I'm glad that you brought that up.
They don't phrase it exactly that way, but that is essentially what it is.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad that you brought that up, because I think that the word faith is a shell game is used with the word faith a lot, because it sounds like you're talking about how I would put it is faith is used in two different ways. One essentially means trust, and one is a more religious version of it. You had a much more nuanced and a better definition on both of those branches than I do. A lot of people will be like, oh, you have faith. I'm like, yeah, certainly. I have faith in a lot of things. I have faith in love. I have faith in, you know, human kindness. I have faith in a lot of things. They're like, oh, well, then you have a faith-based worldview. And it's just like, wait a second. You just switched from trust to religion. That's like saying, my car is a lemon is a fruit, therefore my car is a fruit. You know, it's just like, what are you talking about? That does not make sense to me. But you also mentioned a little bit ago about the difference between approaches, it sounded like. You know, the approach of theists is pretty much proselytizing. You know, it is their obligation to get other people to think along the same lines as they do, evangelical theists specifically. And science, on the other hand, its goal is to be the honest broker. So it's much more difficult for scientists to have conversations with fundamental evangelical theists, but you do. So I'm curious to know, and I consider you an informal science educator, whether you've applied that label to yourself before, whether other people have told you that before. I definitely think that is the case, and I love the fact that you're utilizing technology to give nice small pieces of information in nuanced ways in very easily digestible format. So I would like to know how you place yourself in the skeptic landscape. That is, why do you do what you do?
Well, I live in Texas, which became infamous when our Board of Education was bought out by powerful people that wanted to position a voting bloc so that they could get their type of lessons taught in place of legitimate science or health or history or social studies or what have you. The education system in Texas is deplorable, below the university level, at least. And mm-hmm. our universities apparently are still strong, but the people feeding into them are a joke. There's very little that can be done with that when you have all the powers that be sucking out funding, minimizing teachers, and doing everything they can to undermine all these different studies and try to taint everything toward the position of the religious right. And it's not just science. As I said, it's with health. I mean, look, for example, Texas has the abstinence-only sex education program, which is one of the reasons that one-third of Texas children live below the poverty level, and is also the reason that Texas leads the country in repeat teen pregnancies. The abstinence-only program is an abysmal failure, as are all of the programs endorsed by the religious right. And it strikes me that if you want to be a nationalist, and this is and clearly the creationists, the fundamentalists, largely are very nationalist American type people. But if you really wanted America to be a great country, then you would treat it the way you would a company, where your company is going to continue to train the people working there. You want those people to have a great deal of expertise. You want there to be an advantage to their experience and so on. But the United States, under these type of people, does not do that. They want to have something very different. They want to have a clear division between the haves and the have-nots. They, in many cases, have openly expressed that they don't want to have a middle class. They want to have the wealthy elite, and they want to have the underlings. And they've done a great deal to try to divide these two as much as they possibly can. And they are wholly against education, not just evolution, but education in general, and it doesn't matter what the topic is. Mm-hmm. And it's a very disturbing thing for me to see. And it's a strange thing that it's, I want to see the population of this country rise to their ability rather than have the very people that should be encouraging the next generation instead oppressing them and misleading them, which is absolutely what the religious right is trying to do nationwide.
Okay, so it doesn't sound like you're pigeonholed in increasing scientific literacy per se, but literacy, academic literacy, it seems like you're a proponent of. And you,
yes,
and, from what I'm hearing, if I can paraphrase, that will lift the nation as far as, you know, the quality of students that get into colleges, and therefore increase by an order of magnitude the quality of people that are coming out of college.
It's been often stated that there are certain Oriental or Asian countries that have more honor students than we have students, just by not just by virtue of their population, but also by the way their education standards are. There are some Asian countries where the schools are far better than anything that you're going to get here in Texas, at least. And that concerns me. It concerns me that we have allowed the culture to be the way that it is, that we encourage faith as if it is an attribute when it is not, that we have, as Eleanor Roosevelt put it, you know, small minds discuss people and great minds discuss ideas. And if you come from an Asian background, you might be fortunate enough to come from one that where, you know, your academic accolades are a matter of honor, you know, and how well you do in school reflects on how great you are as a person. But if you come to this country, we are interested, our children, I mean, are interested in the most trivial things. And it's a sad thing that we've allowed our culture to get that way and that we seem to be perpetuating that. You know, when I was a kid, it was right out, you know, we were in the midst of the Cold War. I'm 50 years old. So when I was a little bitty kid, we were launching to the moon. We were gearing up for that. We wanted greater science. We wanted better advances. And we wanted to beat the people in China and in Russia who were competing against us. And there was a great motivation to advance the scientific cause and to increase our understanding. And we have lost that. And it bothers me that we have. And when I was a little kid, one of the heroes of television was a character called Perry Mason. And Perry Mason was one of those characters that was nobody's fool. You can lie to him all you want to, but he's just going to raise an eyebrow and figure out what the truth really is. And we've wandered away from that, too. And we've gotten into people that just readily swallow whatever tripe they're fed without question, without inquiry. And we've praised those who believe without question, without reason, without reservation. And that is always foolish.
Well, this kind of leads me to something that I'm sure you've heard before. And it's about process. It's about how to communicate the values that you have in order to, in order to make sure that your passions, that your voice is heard, to commit to the values that you have. And, I'm going to bust your chops a little bit and say straight up that I love to hear your lecture. I love to hear your presentations. I love to watch your videos, but I have a little bit of a hard time listening to your debate. Because for three reasons. And one is your passion looks a lot like aggression sometimes. And I think that affects your impulse control. At least this is from an observer's, from an outside looking in. Of course, I'm not telling you that you have no impulse control. It's just, this is an observation. And
well, you're not giving me any criticism that my wife doesn't give me.
So those three things, like the aggression that manifests as a lot of interrupting and also a lot of high volume talking. So, and I can't be the first person to tell this to you. So I'm curious to know what your response is to the fact that, however people have phrased it to you in the past, how aggressive your approach is sometimes.
Well, I've recently been hired on as a regular co-host on the Dogma Debate. Okay. And the founder of that show and I have had a number of lectures afterward where I'm being lectured. For not allowing these people enough rope to hang themselves. If I would just shut up a little longer, they would, they would show what fools they are, and then I can go in and gather the slack around the news. And he's got a point there. And so I am trying to amend that as, however I can. So I actually do appreciate the criticism, and I don't want to come off the way that you and, yes, several other people have described me to be.
Okay. No, because like I said, the content is so rock solid that, if the delivery were just a little bit different, man, you'd be hitting home runs left and right. And the reason why I bring this up is because there's a couple of things that it addresses about process in general that I'd like to get your opinion about. One is, I would consider you an activist. You are the kind of person that when Ken Ham shows up to a homeschooling convention in Texas, you show up as well with pickets, making sure that your voice is heard.
In 107 degree heat, yeah.
Yeah, that looked like a mess. And you get into discussion / arguments with people in this heat that have lambasted the worst claims against you in an attempt to prevent you from appearing there. He claimed to the museum or to the place, the conference center that you were picketing out in front of, that you were a neo-Nazi, something absurd like that.
They wanted – yeah, the guy that you're talking about actually called the Houston Museum of Natural Science and tried to – and realized that the guy he was talking to, the director – of that portion of the facility had a Jewish last name, so he thought he would evoke that or use it to his own ends by calling me a Nazi and saying that we were potentially violent. And he made many other accusations too. One of the one that I thought was the funniest was when he accused me of capitalism. He warned other readers not to go to my blog because I was a capitalist, because I happen to be on a blog that has advertising. I'm in a group blog by invitation of a friend, so I'm participating on this again by invitation, and there is the advertisements on the side. Sure. And this guy warns his readers about this as if capitalism were communism or anything else that the religious right was opposed. You know, the religious right is not opposed to capitalism. The guy that is making the accusation against me has on his own page books that he sells because he's been trying to be on the review board for a Texas textbook, and he writes textbooks for homeschool students, wherein, of course, it's full of misinformation and deliberate lies, and he's selling these. But he's warning people about me because somebody else is making a profit on the fact that I'm blogging in their community blog. I just thought that was a hilarious twist.
Oh, juxtaposition of, you know.
Yeah.
You know,
but in the case of the guy we're talking about, that same guy accused me of rejecting reason when he is, in fact, a presuppositionalist himself. He accused me of believing magic when he's the one who believes in extraordinary powers from a supernatural source, which is what the definition of magic is. And he basically accused me of all of his own faults projected upon me.
I saw the clip. Somebody was filming the conversation the two of you had outside, and I don't know whether you posted it or somebody posted it, and I did get a chance to watch that exchange. Now, my follow-up question to that is, and this is a little bit of a tangent, but I'm totally into this particular topic. There was discussion about you and he having a debate. What happened to that?
Yeah. I was hoping that we would be able to set this up at a particular event that's supposed to be going on in San Antonio in October.
Okay.
However, they haven't gotten a date. They haven't gotten a venue. I'm very frustrated about that because I would like to start promoting it right away. If we can't get that secured, then this guy said he would do it in the Houston Museum of Natural Science, but I have issues with that. And the reason is I don't expect him to show up. I expect that because of the topic that he agreed to debate, he will be required to produce positively indicative evidence, evidence that indicates creation. And of course, there isn't any, and he doesn't know that somehow. And somebody else, one of his own supporters or cronies or associates, is going to have to pull him aside and say, you can't have this debate for this reason. Mm-hmm. And so I don't expect him to show up. It would be great if he did, because it's going to be a win either way. But what we want is to have an event that would be independent of his arrival. So I wanted to do the Texas Freethought Convention, which is traditionally done in October, and this year is going to be done in San Antonio. It's not that far from Houston. I would love to have this guy in a debate with me as part of the entertainment to draw people in. But that if he doesn't show up, it's not dependent on that, and I absolutely am not going to waste any funds securing a venue for somebody who isn't going to turn up. We've seen that happen with Ken Miller. In his that speech that he gave, that is the most devastating attack against intelligent design that I've ever seen. Ken Miller speaks for about 2 hours uninterrupted, the spectacular lecture. And what that was a venue that was secured for the purpose of having a debate, and the opponent didn't show up. And so rather than grandstand like that, I want to have just a venue where if he shows up, he provides entertainment, and that would be great. And if he doesn't, we're all going to have a good time anyway, and it's a win-win either way. Now, he wanted to do it in a university setting or some other place where that's the sole attraction. And so when he doesn't show up, of course, we're out money or what have you, and we're not going to do that. In my logic, if Christopher Hitchens could debate Bill Dembski in a mega church, then this guy, David Shorman, can certainly debate me at a free thought conference or similar atheist event, because there are a few left this year.
Well, I hope that comes to fruition. But the fact that you are an activist and that you engage with people like this, I'm curious to know how you balance two things. How do you balance the common rules of courtesy and communication that you need to get your point across with the passion necessary to make sure that your point is represented amongst all the other voices that are trying to get their point across? Because one of them can be very aggressive and one of them can be very flexible, I guess it would be a diplomatic word for it. But how do you balance that?
Well, that's a difficult question. I mean, the venue affords opportunities for different types of deviations, and you have to be aware of what kind of person you're talking about as to what sort of tangents they're going to run on and how do you control that. it's necessary to be very fluent with the argument itself and how to address, for example, when people ask you for a transitional species, they're not asking you for what science would expect of a transitional species. They're asking for a crocoduck, something science couldn't allow. When they ask for the emergence of a new species to prove macroevolution, and you look at the phylogenetic tree and you show, okay, well, you have this new variety emerging on this branch. Well, it's still on that branch. It didn't jump over to this other branch. Well, of course it didn't. That, too, would violate the laws of evolution. So in either case, and in many others, you have to preface the argument with an explanation of what is really expected. And one of the things that I do to try to do that is to engage the person that I'm talking to. It doesn't matter what you explain to them, they will be able to dismiss everything, even without understanding what it is that you're saying, simply by saying, that doesn't prove anything. It is possible to look at every single tree in the forest and not see the forest, right? So you just dismiss whatever, you know, this tree is not perfect, this tree is not perfect, this tree, you can discount everything. Without even examining it. But if you have somebody evoked into giving their own responses, giving what their criteria would be for any given instance, or having them give the definitions and showing that the definitions are legitimate, very quickly you'll see where the motivations are, where they will suddenly say, well, I wouldn't look for any such evidence because I would know that what I believe is already true. Well, okay, well, then you've just betrayed your position, and you've already admitted that you're never going to accept any evidence at all.
Well, another thing that I wanted to bring up about process is I'm a firm believer that the atheist community, and right now you can't see me, but I am using air quotes around community, just because I hate the term, it needs bulldogs, of which I consider you one. And so, like, you know, on top of the fact that I did bust your chops a few minutes ago about process, about, you know, seeming aggressive, about being loud, about being interruptive, there's another part of me that's like, well, yeah, some people need to meet people where they're at. And when they're coming at you at a certain way, they need to know that some people aren't going to stand down to them. And so, you know, so I'm conflicted, admittedly. So how did you kind of fall into that role? I mean, because I know that I'm not the only person that sees you as a bulldog for the atheist community. So, I mean, how did you kind of fall into that? Is that just like your personal style?
I guess I would have to say it's been my personal style for quite a while. Then I, when I got into doing videos on it, it was picked up positively. And then I found myself doing podcasts and other sorts of confrontations. I have many times been on the steps of the state capitol with picket signs and whatnot, and I've just become more involved the more I keep going. So I don't know another way to answer that question.
No, that's great. I mean, I just appreciate your honesty. So I have about a little under 10 minutes left, and I like to finish the show with some concluding questions. And I did give you the introductory questions because I wanted a nice, long, detailed, nuanced response to those. But these concluding questions, I purposely withheld them from you, and I'm hoping to get some pithy answers from you. And let's see if we can fill up the last 10 minutes just answering these.
All right.
And feel free if if I phrase something in such a way that you don't feel like answering, just let me know. So, first one: would the world be better off without theists?
Would the world be better off without people who believe that reptiles from another planet have secretly donned human guises and are manipulating the leaders of our governments? I think that the world would be better off without people that readily believe any kind of unsupported woo. It's not just religion that's the problem. It's pseudoscience in large degree. And, you know, as I said, faith. The aspect of faith in maintaining a belief that is not supported, or perpetuating a belief, or assuming a belief in the first place that is not supported, should be condemned. It should be that we have critical thinking. And there's absolutely not a downside to critical thinking. There is no attribute or benefit to faith. And I'm sorry, you wanted a short and pithy answer, but I think that's about as concise as I can be with that.
That was perfect. Now, you may have answered this previously in our discussion, but try to synopsize your answer for this. What evidence would disprove your worldview?
I don't know. I don't usually describe my perspective as a worldview to begin with. I don't know what aspects you could be addressing. If you're talking about that supernatural things actually exist, then I would say that it would be more like the world of Star Trek, where Spock can demonstrate his mind meld abilities, and the counselor Deanna Troi can, you know, also demonstrate with, you know, repeatable accuracy what her telepathy can do. And we don't have this happening in real life because supernatural things aren't real life.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What question would you most want to be asked by a theist? That is purposely vague.
Yeah. I can't think of one that I would. That's an on the spot thing, and I don't know what kind of question to even consider what I would want someone to ask me. I would like the theist to be sincere in whatever he asked me. They always ask questions they think you can't answer, and they ask it because they think you can't answer. And when they realize, to their horror, that you know the answer and can even show that you're correct, then they need to interrupt the answer so that they can ask you another question which they hope you can't answer. And it is the lack of sincerity that is the problem, not the question.
Gotcha. I think that's a great answer. So the flip side of that question is, what question would you least want to be asked by a theist?
I can't think of a... If the question is sincere, then I welcome it. It wouldn't matter.
Gotcha. So maybe the insincere questions are the ones that you dread the most.
I don't dread any of them, but yeah, I've only ever experienced the insincere questions, the things where they say, "Well, where did eyes come from? We were just wandering around blind in the forest, you know, bumping into trees and stuff before we suddenly developed eyes." And these are people who know that. The evolutionary story is that we came from apes who had eyes, and the apes came from earlier primates who had eyes, and, you know, earlier therapsid mammals and reptiles and so on who all had eyes. But they're deliberately misrepresenting this, and I hate when the questions deliberately misrepresent, or when the answer is rejected, again, as part of a deliberate misrepresentation. When they ask for a new species, and you show, well, here's two dozen new species that were directly observed, a new species of flies or finch, and they say, but it's still a fly or it's still a finch, deliberately trying to misrepresent what it is. You know, it should be, according to them, that, you know, a bird gives birth to an oak tree or something equally absurd, because they're trying to misrepresent it as much as they can so that they can misunderstand it as much as they can, so that they can believe something else, because that degree of misunderstanding is what is required before you can believe that snakes talk.
Okay. Well, that pretty much takes up the time that we have, Aaron Rod. I did want to take some time to thank you very much for your honesty and for the time that you took this afternoon to spend discussing these matters with me. I want everybody who is watching to know that I will be making a post-show wrap-up and posting that to my YouTube channel. And once again, that is youtube.com/user/MautyMan. That's MautyMan. I also encourage everybody to go to YouTube and look up Aaron Ra's channel, A-R-O-N-R-A, and he has tons of videos. He has videos about evolution. He has videos about science in general. He has fantastic instructional videos. Like I mentioned before, I think he's one of the top informal science educators that we have utilizing the technology that is available. So thank you again, Aaron Ra.
Thank you very much.
All right, and we'll see everybody next week.